Welcome to the video for section 8.B, area of regular polygons. And we're going to start with a warm-up because this is an algebra concept that will help explain why we use the formula that we will today. We're going to factor out the greatest common factor of each of these expressions. Now, when we're factoring by a greatest common factor, technically how to think about this is we are undistributing. Okay, and I can see the orientation on my board is a little bit off right now, so bear with me. I'll be right back in just a second. I'm going to reorient. Okay, that should help. Greatest common factor, we're undistributing, like I said earlier. So let's take a look at this first one. If I am undistributing for number one, I'm looking at each of these terms and saying, what can I divide out of both of those terms? So 3x and 9, both of those are divisible by 3, so I can undistribute a 3 and divide it out of both those terms. So 3x, if I divide out the 3, it's just an x. 9, if I divide out the 3, it's just a 3. So what you see in blue there, that is our factored expression. For number 2, 14n and 21nm, I can divide 7 out of both of those numbers, and I can divide an n out. Well, if I take 7n and divide that out of 14n, I'm left with just a regular 2. And for the 21, if I divide out a 7, it's 3. Divided the n out, there's the m left over, though. So that's how number 2 should look like when we've factored out the greatest common factor. For number 3, I've got 6a squared and 2ab. I can take 2a out of each of those terms. If I divide out 2a from the first part, I've got 3 and a, right? If it's a squared, that really means a times a. And I'm only dividing one of those a's out. And for the second term, if I divide out the 2a from 2ab, the b is the only thing left over. We can also do this if there are more than two terms. So like number 4, there are three terms in our expression, 3x to the third, 7x squared, and negative 2x. I can divide the numbers. I can't divide the same number out of all three of those, but I can divide an x out of the whole thing. So I'm going to undistribute an x from each of those terms. That leaves me with 3x to the second power plus 7x minus 2. So just a review of an algebra concept that's going to help explain the lesson today. Section 8.B, I know what you're probably thinking, why are you calling it 8.B? This is a section that is not in our textbook, but it's something that we feel is really neat, interesting, and it's pertinent. It's a bonus section, so that's why it's 8.B. We got a formula for finding the area of regular polygons. Remember, from section 8.1, a polygon is regular if all the sides are congruent and all the angles are congruent. And we've got a really cool math word in today's lesson. That math word is apothem. And if you're looking ahead in your notes, you probably see that under the definitions. Apothem is the correct pronunciation of the word, but some people try and argue that it's actually pronounced apothem. And so that's what our joke plays on, is here we've got an apothem in that regular pentagon. And he scoots out of there. What is that apothem? It's the distance from the center of a regular polygon to the midpoint of one of its sides. So it looks like that if we're looking at a regular polygon. It goes from the center to the midpoint of an opposite side. Right? And then the perimeter, we've already talked about this, but now we've got an actual formal definition. If I add up all the sides going around my polygon, that gives me the perimeter. Okay, our formula for the area of a regular polygon is 1/2 times the apothem times the perimeter. Now, why is that so? Well, here we've got a regular hexagon, and to explain how this formula was constructed, this is just kind of an interesting thing to listen and watch. What if we take that hexagon and we split it up? We take that hexagon and we divide it up into triangles. And then let's take those triangles, and instead of having them in the shape of a hexagon, let's just line them up. So here we've gone and done that. If we wanted to find all of that area, we would add up 1 half times the base times the height, 1 half times the base times the height, 1 half times the base times the height. We'd add that up over and over and over again. Then if we use that concept from our warm-up, take out the greatest common factor of each one, we could factor out 1 half and h. And I'm choosing to leave b plus b plus b plus b plus b. I know that's a greatest common factor as well. We could factor that out. But I'm going to leave that all in parentheses, because I want you to think, when we had this hexagon, what is base plus base plus base plus base plus base plus base? Well, what I'm really doing is taking the base of this triangle plus the base of this triangle plus the base of this triangle and so on. I'm finding the perimeter. So base plus base plus base plus base plus base, that is our perimeter. So the area equals 1 half times the height times the perimeter. Okay, and then we look at, well, what is h? That wasn't in our formula at all. The height of each of these triangles, the straight up and down height, is going from the middle of the base towards the center of that hexagon. So that h is really our apothem. So just so you can see, I don't know, if this helps, that's great. If you want to just remember the formula, that's fine too. But I think this does a nice job of explaining why that formula looks how it does. Okay, so let's get to the actual math. You can see decimals. This is definitely a calculator-oriented section, so you're going to want to have those calculators ready. To find the area of the regular polygon, well, our area formula, 1 half times apothem times perimeter. We use a capital P to denote the perimeter. That's something that we'll carry through into chapter 9. So we need to find, what is the apothem? What is the perimeter? Well, the apothem, we've got two different measurements that go from the center. One is the actual apothem, and here's, I got a funny play on words. One's the apothem, one's an impotha. So they kind of sound similar. This 2.19 is our apothem because it goes to the midpoint of one of the sides. This 2.24, that's our impostor. That's the one that's not going to the midpoint. It is extra information just trying to confuse us. Okay, so I know the apothem is 2.19, the apothem, I should say. Now the perimeter. They tell me one side is 2. Well, then I know all these other sides are 2s as well. There is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 sides. So my perimeter is just 7 sides times each one's length of 2. It's 14. So one of the first things we want to do, we can't just take numbers from the diagram and multiply them together or try and force them into the formula. We need to be sure we have the ones we're looking for. So if the perimeter is 14, that means my area formula is 1 half times 2.19. times my perimeter of 14. And here's where we can go to the calculator. For the 1 half, I'm just going to type in 0.5. I know that's what 1 half means. Times the apothem, 2.19. Apothem, I should say. Times the perimeter of 14. And I get 15.33. Okay. They don't give us any units, so I'm just going to put a U. Area squarea still applies, so it's units squared. U squared. Okay, so I want you to take what we did in that last example, pause the video, see if we can't come up with some answers for numbers 1 and 2 here. Okay, for number 1, here's what the formula should look like with the numbers plugged in. The area equals 1 half times the apothem, that's 2.06. times the perimeter, which is 3 times 5, 15. And if we punch that into a calculator, I get 15.45 units squared. All right, for number two, area equals 1/2 times the apothem, that's 7.24, times the perimeter, which is 48. 8 sides, each one is 6 units long, 6 times 8 is 48. So 0.5 times 7.24 times 48 gives me an answer of 173.76. Oops, not 6, 76 units squared. And so hopefully we came up with those answers, we're able to type those into the calculator in the right way, and we're able to identify that for number one, the 2.55 was not the right apothem, apothem. Same thing for number two, that 7.84, that's the imposter. All right, example two, they give us this number just kind of floating in the middle of the shape. That is the area. So the area of that hexagon is 5.85. We need to use that to find the measure of the apothem. What's the length of a segment that goes from the center to a midpoint of one of the sides? That's what we're solving for. So we're going to set up the problem just like we have in the past. We're going to start with our formula. 1/2 times apothem times perimeter. Well, I don't know the perimeter yet. I know that one side is 1.5, so the perimeter is 1.5 times the 6 sides that there are. It equals 9. So if I plug in the numbers, the area 5.85 equals 1/2 times the apothem, that's what I'm trying to find, times my perimeter of 9. And we just have to solve for A. First thing I like to do whenever I see a 1/2, I like to cancel that out. I'm going to multiply both sides by 2. Now, on the right, all that does is cancel out the 1/2. And on the left, I actually multiply that out, 5.85 times 2. It's 11.7. So 11.7 equals A times 9. To solve for A, I would just divide both sides by 9. And my answer is 1.3. So A equals 1.3 units. Notice we aren't finding area, so I don't square my units. It's just a regular U. Okay, once again, we're at a yellow slide, so pause the video. But maybe before you do that, just remember this number inside, that is the area. So the area of that triangle is 2.71. The area of this shape is 1.55. Go ahead and pause the video. I'll check back in a couple seconds. All right, hopefully we've come up with some answers here. Let's see what this looks like with numbers plugged in. My area, 2.71, equals 1/2 times the apothem I'm trying to find times my perimeter, which is 7.5. Well, if I multiply both sides by 2, that cancels out the 1/2, and I have 5.42, not 5 times 42, 5.42 equals A times 7.5, and I just need to divide both sides by 7.5. If I do that, let's turn to the calculator, 5.42. Divided by 7.5, I get 0.7226 repeating. Okay, now how should I clean up that answer? We said that if they don't tell us otherwise, we should round to 2 decimal places. So here I'm looking at this 2. Should I keep it or round it up? The following digit is a 2, so it stays at 0.72. units. For number two, I've got 9 sides, so my perimeter equals 4.5. That's one of the first things we need to know. That's how I got the 7.5 in the last example. I did 2.5 times the 3 sides. And if I set up that equation, area 1.55 equals 1/2 times the apothem I'm trying to find times my perimeter 4.5. Well, let's go through the steps. Multiply both sides by 2. That'll cancel out the 1/2 on the left. And I get 3.1 equals A times 4.5. And I just need to divide away that perimeter, 4.5. All right, so 3.1 divided by 4.5 gives me 0.68 repeating. And if I'm going to round that to two decimal places, think about it. 0.8 repeating means 0.68888 on. So I'm looking at this 8. Does it round up or does it stay the same? Well, it's followed by another 8. So the actual apothem measurement is 0.69 units. Okay, so some tricky math, mainly because it involves decimal points. But really, it doesn't pose too much of a threat to us because we can use our calculators and come up with very accurate answers with those. All right, we solved for the apothem. Now let's solve for the perimeter of the polygon. Again, this kind of floating number inside, that is our area measurement. So if I start with my formula, area equals 1/2 apothem times perimeter. I know the area is 10.39, and that equals 1/2 times the apothem. Ooh, which one's the apothem? It has to go to a midpoint, so I have to take this 1.73. I'm not using the 2. And I'm just solving for the perimeter, capital P. So what are my steps going to be? Well, I'm going to multiply both sides by 2. Right? That cancels out 1/2. So I get 20.78 equals 1.73p. And to finish solving, I'm just going to divide both sides by 1.73. Basic Algebra 1 solving skills. Even though they involve decimals, we can do the finishing step in a calculator. 20.78 divided by 1.73, I get 12.0115. Right? And this number keeps going on and on, but I'm only going to round to two decimal places. So I'm looking at this 1. What follows it? Do I round it up or keep it the same? Well, it's followed by another 1, so it stays the same. 12.01 units. Again, they're not telling me to find area, so they're just regular units. Okay, just like the other examples, I've given you 2 to try on your own. Pause the video, come up with some answers, and we'll check them in a few seconds. Okay, we're back. Let's check number 1. My area, 4.97, equals 1/2 times the apothem, that's 1.17 in this case, times the perimeter. Let's multiply both sides by 2. That cancels out the 1/2 on the right-hand side, and I get 9.94 equals 1.17p. To finish solving for p, I got to undo multiplication, divide away that 1.17, and let's turn to the calculator. And I get 8.4957. And then the number keeps going, of course, but I'm only going to round to two decimal places. I'm looking at this 9. It's followed by a 5, so that 9 rounds up to a 10. So my perimeter equals 8.50 units. Okay, so that was an interesting rounding thing. When it rounds up to a 10, we have to add 1 to the 4 as well. So it does round up to 8.50. Let's turn our attention to number 2. We want to find the perimeter of that square. Area equals 1/2 times apothem, that's 0.87, times the perimeter, that's what I'm solving for. Cancel out the 1/2, let's multiply both sides by 2. That means 6.06 equals 0.87p. And need to undo multiplication to solve for p. Divide both sides by 0.87. And let's turn to the calculator quickly. We've got 6.06 divided by 0.87. That gives me 6.9655. And again, that goes on and on and on. But I'm just rounding this 6. It's followed by a 5, so it does round up. So my perimeter equals, this 9 rounds up, or the 6 rounds up to a 7, so it's 6.97 units. Yeah, please ignore this arrow up here. That 9 does not round. It's just the 6 that rounds. So 6.97 should be our final answer. Okay, and lastly, we end with a yellow slide. This is a U-try example. This is a little bit of a challenge problem. So please pause the video, try and come up with an answer, and I'll check back with you in a few seconds. But if you get this one right, you should feel very, very proud of yourself. You get this concept very, very well. So I'll check back in a few seconds. All right, let's have a look. The area of a regular decagon, okay, we got to know that decagon means 10 sides. That area is 250 feet squared. It has an apothem of 5 feet. What's the length of one side? Just one. Okay, they do say that it's a regular decagon, and you know that's kind of crucial because this whole section was about regular polygons. But let's see. If I start with the formula, always a good place to start. Formula for a regular polygon, 1/2 times apothem times perimeter. The area is 250. That equals 1/2 times the apothem, that's 5, times my perimeter, which I don't know. So just like the last examples, we're going to solve for the perimeter first. Well, let's multiply both sides by 2 to cancel out the 1/2. 500 equals 5 times p. If I divide both sides by 5, I find that the perimeter is 100 feet. Okay? And it's really tempting to circle that answer and say, I got it, I'm done. But what we've just found is the perimeter, we haven't answered the question. The question asks for the length of one side. So if that goes all the way around the shape and there are 10 sides, I'm going to take that perimeter and divide it by how many sides there are. When I do that division, 100 divided by 10 equals 10 feet for one side. So if you were able to go through that and come up with an answer of 10 feet, you really get how to use this formula, and you should feel pretty good about yourself. All right, that concludes Chapter 8. This was one of the tougher chapters, one of the longer chapters that we've gone through in this class, and I think personally one of the most important and applicable chapters that we've covered this year. I mean, they're all applicable, but this one really applies itself to real life, finding areas of polygons. As we get ready for Chapter 9, please remember that we're using formulas, and we're going to keep using formulas throughout this next chapter and really pretty much for the rest of the year. So I really hope that we've developed some confidence using those formulas, and that we feel good about Chapter 8, because that's really going to tie into what we're doing the whole rest of the year. But right for now, that's it for Chapter 8.